Welcome to Mike's Motorworx, and today we're going to give you a little tech episode and show you how to change the connecting rod bearings on your engine. Check it out. All right, John, so a few episodes ago, we saw that a lack of oil caused you to spin a rod in the LS in the S10. Now, it's important for viewers to understand this isn't the same LS that was built for the Blazer. This was done previous to that,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Did you rebuild the low end on this one when you replaced it?
The only thing I did on the bottom end of this one is just replace the bearings.
Okay, so there it is. The bearings had already been replaced once. So we're going to show you how to replace the bearings because one of them is spun, and we're going to show you how to check the tolerances. So, John, what are we doing?
Well, basically, we're going to use what they call Plastigage. And basically, what it does is it goes in between the bearing and the actual crank itself for the connecting rod, and that actually tells you exactly how much clearance is there to meet requirements according to GM specifications.
All right, so we're going to show you how to do that. Is there anything that you need to cover right now here in front of the camera?
No, we're going to have to get a little bit closer because it's a really small, thin piece of plastic, so we'll get a better close-up, and we'll explain more of how this works here in just a minute.
Cool. All right, check it out. So this is our subject. It is the 5.3 LS that was sitting inside the S10. And if you saw the drag racing episode, we know that we ran into a slight issue with it. And we pulled a motor on it. And we found that we had spun bearing and various reasons why that happened. And just basically sometimes things are overlooked. And inside here, you can already see that it has some mileage on there, and we're getting ready to kind of get things rolling with this.
So this is Plastigage, that little green piece right there. And we're going to do is torque this to specifications, and what it's going to do is it's actually going to compress against that piece of plastic, and it comes with a gauge that tells you exactly how thick it is. They offer two different sizes depending on your clearance. This goes up to 0.075, and then you get a red one that goes from 0.53 up to 0.053 up to 0.1. So we're actually going to compress this and tighten it down to GM specs. So we're going to torque it to 15 foot-pounds, and then we're going to go back and do 85 degrees additional. Then we're going to pull it all back apart and then check to see how much it has compressed according to the gauge.
So what clearance are you looking for after you go through that process?
Well, GM recommends between 0.023 to 0.076. So what we're going to be aiming for is somewhere around the 0.04 range.
0.04 range. So if we don't fall within that, what it needs to be done?
Go to a oversized bearing.
Fair enough. So it doesn't involve, you know, grinding the crank or anything. It just involves changing
the bearings.
Fair enough. All right. So let's see what's involved here.
All right.
And how many foot-pounds?
15 foot-pounds.
15.
Now we're going to 85 additional degrees.
All right, so quick question. we have the engine out of the vehicle. Could this be done on a general vehicle, not like our custom application because of low, you know, clearances and such inside the engine bay, but could this be done off of or in while the engine is still in the vehicle?
Yes, it can be done in vehicle. It is very tight, but the Silverados do have a lower cross support that does come out, so you can do it in the vehicle. It's not recommended, but it can be because it's just the connecting rods.
Okay, so
the main bearings, you can, but there becomes an issue because of the weight of the transmission, because of the way the powertrain is set up. It's a little bit more difficult, but yes, it can be done in the vehicle.
Can be done in the vehicle. All right, a good deal. So if somebody was working on home, say like their Dodge or their Ford or, you know, another vehicle that didn't have the engine out of it, it can be done, but it's recommended to go ahead and take the engine out of the vehicle. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right, fair enough.
All right, now we can see on the bearing how much it has squeezed down. So there's the plastic gauge right there.
Okay, so I'm looking at the, hold on, let me look right here. There we go. Go ahead.
All right, so that's the plastic gauge. And basically we're just gonna take this measurement here. So that right there has us at 0.005. So that's 0.005 of an inch. So we are actually within tolerance for this bearing. So we're going to do the same process on all of them.
On all of them. Sounds like fun. So we're going to do this 8 more times. Yeah. So John's had a chance to go ahead and check out the clearances, the tolerances on all the main bearings. John, were there any surprises in there?
None that we were not anticipating. The back two cylinders, number 7 and 8, was out of spec, and it was just barely out, out of my personal spec. So we went ahead and put two new connecting rod bearings in, reseated them, remeasured them, and it is now within my specifications, which is right there in the middle where we want.
Good deal, good deal. Now, something that we noticed was that on one side, and you can see if you go back on the video, and I'll show it here as it's playing, that on one side of the connecting area, it was a little bit thicker with that green strip, and on the other side, it was thinner. Now, somebody might point that out and say that's wrong. Is it wrong?
Not necessarily. And the reason why is because of oiling. If you have a perfectly smooth, perfectly flat place, where is the oil going to go?
Ah.
It's got to drain out somehow. Yes, too much draining is not a good thing. If it's too flat, then it's not going to allow the oil to get out. But also, at the same aspect, if it's too smooth, too flat,
mm-hmm.
You can build up too much pressure and create other issues.
Now, we talked about it on the last episode here, that your intent is to go ahead and put some forced induction on this. Is there anything that needs to be considered on the low end with forced induction like that?
Not on the bottom end. I've seen a lot of people...
We had a little Mac error there, so let's pick up right where we are. Is there anything that needs to be considered for the low end in regards to forced induction?
Not on this particular motor. Generally on the LS, I've seen a lot of guys go right off the bat with big blowers or twin turbos with 100% stock bottom end putting out 1,000+ horsepower with a stock bottom end, bare bones original.
And is that because of the 6-bolt mains?
Yeah, the 6-bolt mains are really reliable. It's got good bearings in there. So what most people do is when they do this build, they go through it and just put new rod bearings and main bearings in with the stock setup, and it can handle every bit of it.
Good deal, good deal. So then this will pretty much be the last time that we open this bottom end up before it goes back inside the truck.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, once we get this bottom end back in, we'll have the motor running, and then we'll worry about putting the blower set up. I haven't quite decided whether we're going roots or centrifugal style, where the blower sits off to the side. I got to make some more measurements to make sure I have enough room for whichever scenario we go.
Sure.
So hopefully we won't have to worry about the bottom end anymore.
On your engine. Check it out. Can we do one more take? It's connecting rod bearings, right?
Yes.
Okay. Lucy.